All right. It is official now. We're ready to go. Thank you guys for coming out. I do want you to know maybe just a little bit of the nuances. There's been some confusion as we've communicated kind of what's happening this weekend. Is typically we do an imperfect conference and have different things come in, and so it's well known. This was an equipping event that landed in our lap. Jared was up to do a conference in kind of South Georgia, and I got word that it was a canceled conference. Jordan, who had kind of been working with me in that, said, hey, it's canceled. And so I was like, hey, man, you still want to come to Atlanta? And, you know, with COVID, I think him regularly being out and speaking to different churches and ministries had like his fourth cancellation. So he was interested. We said, great, well, we'll make an equipping event, and it'll be a smaller crowd. It'll be better just for a shot in the arm, and he's excited to be here. So tonight is an invite only, not because we think you guys are better than other people. It's an invite only because we wanted our leaders to come, and I think there's time when teaching and equipping can happen that the gospel can infuse in leaders, because as your leadership goes in a church, so goes the church. And so for us to be in a room together as life group leaders, elders, pastors, staff, we got men's leaders, women's leaders here, deacons are here. I think it's just helpful that we're in a room together going as leaders. Is that me? You hear that? Is it probably somebody's guitar? I bet you it's Chess's keyboard is what it is. I do want to share with you, though, a couple things. If you don't know who Jared Wilson is, he's been with us before doing a men's conference. He's works for Midwestern Seminary. He's an author, and he's works with a local church in charge of their residency program there in Liberty, right? Liberty Baptist Church. And so he's a man of the local church, he's a man of the educated world, and he's an author who's got a number of things. And we're actually going to give away some books of his tomorrow. You can still have a chance to win one of those books, even if you're not coming with us. The first I wanted to put up and just let you see is a novel he's written for probably young adults or students, or if you just like good kind of fiction, suspense, thriller kind of writing. It was a new push for him as a writer to do that in a novel form, and it's recently come out. It's called Echo Island, so we're going to be giving that away tomorrow. Two of his recent books around that time, too. The next one is The Gospel According to Satan. Now, don't get angry and don't throw anything yet. You remember C.S. Lewis wrote Screwtape Letters, this really cool interaction of one chief devil communicating to another. This is similar to that. He said, hey, you know, if our enemy, the greatest enemy to the kingdom, actually came as an angel of light and can not come with red horns, you know, horns and a red face and a pitchfork, and we think it's like horror movies, but he actually comes and it's just subtle. What kind of lies would he teach about the gospel? So I've read this book. It's fascinating read because he's basically saying, here's what I'd want you to believe, but you're reading a lie, and then it's clarified on how the gospel really helps. So if you like that kind of reading, I recommend this one to you. And then the next one is The Gospel-Driven Church. It's kind of what he's known for as far as, I think, DNA that he's adding to the current Christian movement in the Western world is just keeping guys, churches, and students gospel-centered. And he's a guy who's had a career that's been up and down, like all of us, and varied in ministry, and he just understands it. And so it's a really, really helpful book. A lot of what we strive to do at this place is paralleled in partnership there. And then the other one you can't see yet because it's coming out March 2nd is his follow-up to that. If that's for the church, then this is for leaders and really the call to be a pastor. So there's a book coming called Gospel-Driven Ministry, An Introduction to the Calling and Work of a Pastor. So that's coming out March 2nd, right? Now, I would encourage you with these pictures to go support the Jared Wilson Get His Daughters Through College Fund and tell your friends about it and share the things online. He will not be a self-promoter of those things. That's just not who he is. But we believe in him, in the ministry through his writing. So we encourage you to buy these books. We don't really typically recommend something without going, man, these are worth it. And all of these are great. I just got this today. I'm looking forward to diving into this. So if you benefit from it, if you benefit from tonight or tomorrow, let people know about his writings and the ministry there and the Midwestern Seminary and that. The other thing that I think is pretty cool is we try to be partners with gospel-minded churches. And we have one of those with us. Drew Warner, come on up here. This is my friend Drew. This is a guy who befriended me as soon as I got here 5 years ago, and we had some ministry together. And gatherings together that kind of started it. He was is a pastor at Perimeter Church, but will be kind of transitioning to planting a church. And better than me talk about him, he's here. He's good at speaking about what he loves, so I'm going to let him talk, okay? So, Drew, tell him what you're doing.
Yeah. Thanks, Jared. We're blessed to be here. Jared and I were talking. So, I guess back in October, my wife Laura is here with me, and some of those friendships that we've had for a long time with folks who found out that this is the direction that we're going, and they said, well, we're interested in this. And so Jared said, why don't you guys come to hear Jared Wilson and come join us? And so we're here. So thank you for the invitation. But Laura and I have been in Sugar Hill for 16 years, and probably for 8 to 10 years, I've had it kicking around in my head, should we start a church in Sugar Hill? I don't really want to do that, but I love the people here, and maybe that would be something that God would want us to do. So should we do it? When do we do it? Just a lot of questions. And I always thought, Lord, I'm willing to do it. We're willing to do it, but you've got to make it very clear. And you know where to find us, and we'll do whatever you want, you know, for ministry and for the kingdom. So in October, Perimeter came to me, and they said, we think you ought to start a church in Sugar Hill. That's right. And they said, what do you think about that? I said, I'm in. And they said, well, why don't you go talk to Laura, pray about it, and just let us know what you think. So I came home, and she said, well, how was your meeting today? I said, well, they think we should start a church in Sugar Hill. She said, well, did they give you any other options? And I said, no, they didn't. And I said, but I didn't ask for any, because I can't think of another option that they might give us that would compare to this. I just feel like this is what we're supposed to do, and God made it clear. He gave me one option. But we're excited about that, and so we're looking forward to that. And I'll just tell you guys, I'm going to brag on your pastor. He's been a great friend, and he's one of the first guys I came and told. I said, you know, he's known this is kind of kicking around. I said, looks like it's going to happen. We're moving in that direction. He said, you guys can use our space if you need it. If you need an office, you can office here. He said, if you need software that just for sermon prep and Bible study and all that, if you don't have software, I'm good at this. We'll buy it for you if Perimeter doesn't do that. And so Jared has been just incredibly gracious and a great support and a great encourager. So anyway, thank you for having us here. Thank you, Jared.
You know, it's not the gathering where we're going to read, sing, preach, pray, and see the Bible, but it's the Lord's people together. And so, Hector, if you want to bring your team up here, I've asked him to put a little team together and just get a couple songs that I think when we continue in our worship, even through singing, it gets our heart ready to hear. And so they're going to sing a couple things. If you want to stand up, you can. If you want to sit down, you can. If you want to run through the aisles, this is not your place. Okay? But I think you guys know Hector and his leading. It's just to get our hearts right, because I think what Jared has for us talking about gospel-driven leadership will be really helpful from the Word. So let me pray, and then it's yours, man. Father, thanks. Thanks for tonight. Thanks for the opportunity for your people to gather. We do pray for Jared and his message, that you will empower him with the Spirit you've sealed him with to proclaim that which is true in your Word. And for us now, would you help our hearts and our minds settle after a busy week of raising kids and school and working and activities and trying to head into a weekend? The best thing we can do is just pause and reflect and remember who's in charge, and that we have the best news in the world that shapes us from the inside out. So we want to learn, we want to hear, we want to be transformed in this, and we want to live out the gospel as we gather. So we pray these things in your name. Amen.
Amen. I am going to have you guys stand up. Is that okay? Still no running up and down the aisle, but if you guys would, stand up. This is 1 John 4. It says, beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God. And whoever loves has been born of God and knows God. Anyone who does not love God, or does not love, does not know God, because God is love. In this love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. And this is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Amen. Thank you. Christ alone. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. Amen. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, so here in the death of Christ I live. Amen. By darkness slain, then bursting forth on glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. That's right. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought by the precious blood of Christ. No guilt. No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry, that's right, to find Jesus. So no power of hell, no scheme of man, can ever pluck me from his hand. Here in the power of Christ, I'll stand. Are you grateful for this love, church? Thank you. Invite up Jared Wilson.
Well, good evening. Thanks so much for having me out here. This is a grand experiment for me to see if I can actually, I'm experimenting with the font. This is something new to me, the cheaters. Conspiracy theories are a big deal right now. I have a conspiracy theory. And it's a little bizarre, but I went in about 3 weeks or so ago to get new contact lenses. So you have to have an exam to get the new contact lenses. And the doctor says, even with your new contacts, you probably want to get some of the, you know, the magnifying, glasses, the cheaters, which immediately, I know I'm getting older, but there's like milestones, right? And that's one of them. Like, okay, all right. And here's my conspiracy theory. So I didn't notice a problem reading anything up close. Like, I didn't go in saying, I'm having real trouble reading books at night in bed or anything like that. I got it was like, $12 for four of these, right, at Costco. They're not anything. They're not, it's not technology, I guess is what I'm trying to say. And I got them, and now I cannot read anything up close without these on. That sounds fishy to me. I never was laying in bed going, I can't really read this book. I didn't have trouble looking at my iPad until I got the cheaters, and now I have to have them every time. So there's something going on. That's my conspiracy theory. Less controversial. Let me pray for us, and I'll pray for me as well, and then we'll get started. Heavenly Father, thank you for these precious souls. I pray that you would help us to love your grace more and more. Thank you for the gift of your Son, the embodiment of love, who is sent for us, sacrificed for us, risen and glorified and living to intercede for us. Thank you for the advocate of your Son. We ask for your Holy Spirit as well. We're thankful for the gift of him. We ask that he would be here opening our hearts and eyes to behold more and more glory that there is to be had through your Son. And it's in his name, the name of Christ Jesus, that we pray. Amen. What I'd like to do this evening is kind of share with you more of a topical talk. Tomorrow's will be an exposition of a text. But this evening, I'd like to kind of do really a survey of the shape of gospel-driven leadership. Now, the way that I'm going to do that is primarily looking through the lens of the pastor. We'll be looking at specific examples related to pastoral ministry, but I'm going to make wider application outside of that. And I think even in the specifics, the focus, circumstantial focus on pastoral ministry, that if you're not an elder, that you should, as a Christian leader, be able to apply some of the principles that is there as well. So I want to begin with this. This is essentially a vignette from the life of a pastor. Those of you who are elders may be able to resonate with this. This comes from the depths of my soul, okay? A vignette from the life of the pastor. It's midweek, Jared, but Sunday is coming. Your desk is arrayed with commentaries and other reference texts. You have pen and paper, laptop, and logos. The Bible is under your nose. The text is calling to you. It is taming you. It is mastering you. You toil away by lamplight. Over the next several days, even as you run errands and carry out administrative tasks, play with your kids, meet with church folks, the sermon is just always there brewing in your brain. Your mind and your heart are mulling it, chewing it, gnawing on the text like a dog with a bone. You pray over that sermon. You stare at your outline until the structure seems to sing. And come Saturday night, you're still at the kitchen table, pen between your teeth, your brow furrowed, your eyes on the prize. If you could sweat blood over this sermon, you would. Your wife brings you a cup of coffee. She puts her hand on your shoulder. She says, "Our church is so lucky to have you." And you look up her, you look up at her beaming and say, "I know." You can hardly sleep Saturday night. You wake up before the alarm goes off. You've been preaching in your sleep. You're preaching in the shower. You're preaching in the car on the drive over. You are raring to go. This is it. It's showtime, the big day. This is the day the Lord has made. It is once again time to part the waters. You're shaking hands, you're pinching the cheeks of babies. During the worship in song, you feel as though you could fly away, soar through the roof of the sanctuary. Your hands are raised, your heart begins to beat more quickly. There's a good knot in your stomach, and you practically bound up to the pulpit when it's time to deliver that sermon. And it is so good. It is the best biblical oratory delivered in at least a 5-mile radius. And since at least the Sunday before, your exposition is meaty, your illustrations are stirring, your application is convicting, the turns of phrases are clever, the insights are deep, and the proclamations are strong. You could die in that pulpit. And you look out to the eager faces before you, those woolly sheep who have gathered into this pen this morning to be fed from the wisdom that is on high. And you see more than a few faces that are lit up, but not with wonder, but with the electronic glow of illuminated phones. And you think to yourself, I hope they're on their Bible app. A few people look angry. A few people are definitely asleep. A few people laugh, but not when you told a joke. And many people are smiling, you're glad to see, but their eyes do not seem to register what you're saying. Their smiles, you fear, are the smiles of Sunday morning routines, a kind of grin and bear it. When you pronounce the words "in conclusion," they seem a little too responsive. Bibles shut across the room. People sit up straight, anticipating having to stand up for the last song and needing to make a rush for the kiddos. You're done and you pray, and they fold up their message notes or their bulletin outlines and they stick them in their Bibles or they put them in their back pockets where they sit on them with their butts. You picture the outline that you have worked up from the core of your being and the cellar of intellectual affliction being shoved down into the side pocket of car doors with McDonald's wrappers. And then you go home, and your wife, oddly, says nothing. And you get up on Monday morning after hitting snooze 3 times, and you head into the office, and you sit at your desk, and you look at your calendar, and you look at your email inbox, and you look at a blank page where the next Sunday sermon is supposed to begin, and you think, what am I doing? What on earth am I doing? What words do we have? What message do we have in a world of religious noise, with so much competing for our attention, in a church culture that offers countless steps and tips and helpful hints, a million ways to pull yourself up by your bootstraps? What is the biblical shepherd actually called to do? The spirits of pragmatism and consumerism so easily creep into our thinking on even Christian leadership. It creeps into our very modes of being that we forget both how to be a leader and how to be a human being. But Christianity is fundamentally antithetical to pragmatism and consumerism. So the spiritual disciplines are so necessary here, scripture reading and prayer, the divine dialogue that we engage in to nurture our friendship with Jesus. But also things like rest and community. They remind us of our dependence. They put us in tune with our finiteness, our creatureliness. So I want to offer 4 rhythms this evening, 4 rhythms of the leadership life that, driven by grace, can help you stifle the temptation to justification by success or approval and put you back in the place of experiencing God's true power. The first rhythm is this: meditating on your qualifications. Meditating on your qualifications. It's astounding to me how little awareness the general evangelical public shows of the biblical qualifications of character and integrity for leadership. We prioritize gifts and talents over authentic spirituality and willing accountability. And then we either act shocked when it blows up in our faces, or we just excuse and dismiss violations of character and morality with trite religious cliches and cheap grace. Nobody's perfect. Everybody's human. We all make mistakes. Evangelicals are woefully illiterate on what actually makes a Christian leader a Christian leader. For instance, there are standards given for pastors. Pastors, in essence, the Bible says, must be this tall to ride this ride. And we think, it's fine. We'll hold on to him. Why should everybody else get to have the fun? And then we're surprised when guys get thrown from the car when it goes into a loop. We have scripture passages that tell us what an elder is to be. Here's an example, 1 Timothy chapter 3. Therefore, an overseer must be above reproach, husband of one wife, sober-minded, self-controlled, respectable, hospitable, able to teach, not a drunkard, not violent but gentle, not quarrelsome, not a lover of money. He must manage his own household well, with all dignity, keeping his children submissive. For if someone does not know how to manage his own household, how will he care for God's church? He must not be a recent convert, or he may become puffed up with conceit and fall into the condemnation of the devil. Moreover, he must be well thought of by outsiders, so that he may not fall into disgrace, into a snare of the devil. And we have parallel and supplemental qualifications in Titus chapter 1 and in 1 Peter chapter 5. And taking those 3 main passages into composite, what do we see? We see, first of all, that an eagerness for ministry, an eagerness for leadership, does not equate to a qualification. A sense of calling, for instance, does not equate to qualification. Notice this also. Skills and gifts do not authenticate qualification. In fact, the only skill set mentioned is this able to teach. It's really the one sort of qualification that distinguishes elder from the office of deacon. Able to teach. That's the only thing you could construe as a gift or even as a skill set. The rest of those qualifications are character issues. They are spiritual dispositions. They are qualities of a person. It says nothing, you will notice, about dynamic leadership. It says nothing about vision casting or being a catalytic anything. Now, those aren't bad things. They're not bad things at all. But they aren't the qualifications. And so every leader must meditate on their qualifications more than on their accomplishments. Your accomplishments adorn your qualifications, but they should never replace them. What do we know of the high-profile ministerial collapses that we've seen? And just in the last couple of weeks, there's been a major report about a leading figure. Again, it's just every month it feels like there's another one. What do we know of these collapses? Most of these men had disqualified themselves long before anything became public. Long before they, quote-unquote, fell. And sometimes I have even quibbles with that language. Because these are intentional choices that these men are making. These men are coasting on their success. They're coasting on their gifts. And very often, the realms of accountability or alleged accountability around them are content to let them do that. It's going so well. How can you argue with this success? How can you argue with the results? Now, we all know instinctually that something being popular doesn't make it right. In fact, we very often argue that with others who are promoting explicit sin. Just because a lot of people agree with it doesn't make it okay. And yet, there's something that happens in the evangelical culture where we begin to embrace a grayness on that ourselves, especially when it comes to high-profile leaders. Every fall begins with a failure of qualifications before it even gets to these behavioral sins. I've even seen, I don't know if you've ever seen this, Jared, perhaps you've seen this. There are public pastors, ministers, who say that their disqualification is their qualification. The reason I'm an effective minister is because I've blown up my life. Well, I don't actually think the Bible says that. I don't think that's what it says. It's a great way of poking the scriptures in the eye. Here's why this is important. Because you can even spin your spiritual state, market it, massage it in your own heart if things are going really well, if people are responding well, if there is quote-unquote success, if there is numeric growth, if the feedback is good. You can begin to excuse, even in your own mind, the areas of your life and heart that you know you ought to be convicted by. One of the hardest exercises that I give the ministry residents at Liberty Baptist Church, it comes near the end. Actually, they're in the middle of this assignment right now. It's actually due at the end of this month. They have to interview their wife on these qualifications, ask their wife to score them on each of the biblical qualifications. How am I doing in self-control? How am I doing in gentleness? How am I doing in quarrelsomeness? How am I doing with managing the household well? How am I doing, et cetera, with hospitality? And the wife has to give him a score from 1 to 5 and then give the reasons for that. And there has to be a in-person interview that, you know, because the guys will just like, they want to hand the sheet over to the wife, just give it to me when you're done, you know, kind of thing. You actually have to ask her, how am I doing in this area? And hear the verbal response. It's the most intimidating thing that they do. If you're not a pastor, here's where you may go with this. Think of the fruit of the Spirit. In fact, there's a lot of overlap between the qualifications for eldership and the fruit of the Spirit. Gentleness and self-control, those things are in there. Being a peaceful person, a patient person. You may look there. Rather than immediately rate yourself, I think it's helpful and tells you some important things to rate yourself based on your skill level and the response to your leadership and all those sorts of things, the success of your area, your sphere of leadership. Ask yourself, what kind of person am I? Not just how am I performing or how am I producing, but what is the state of my heart before the Lord? Am I growing as a person who is becoming more and more conformed to the image of Christ? That goes a lot deeper. You end up asking a lot harder questions. It's a lot more difficult to pull off. In fact, as difficult as it is to create growth and success, this is harder because you cannot do it apart from the power of the gospel. That's why, by the way, this is a grace-driven rhythm. Because you may be asking me, you're talking about like measuring myself and comparing myself. It doesn't sound very grace-driven at all. It actually sounds pretty legalistic. I'm trying to compare myself and measure myself. Well, here's why it ought to be a grace-driven rhythm. Because to become the kind of person you are called to be, you must lean into the power of the gospel. It won't come about through the refining of your skill set, becoming a better speaker, a better administrator. None of those things is going to create this disposition in you. Only closeness with Christ will do that. And so you must lean into the gospel. Second rhythm, fasting from being needed. Fasting from being needed. There is a consistent dynamic in many churches where the pastor or pastors supply the ministry and the people supply the need for the ministry. It creates a deformed kind of religious codependence. Here's what I would ask of every leader, not just a pastor, but every leader. Really, I mean, what I'd ask of every parent or spouse, are you addicted to being needed? Are you addicted to being needed? What can often result in the congregational context is a presumptuous and idolatrous level of expectation on the pastor. I think pastors must shepherd their congregation wisely from becoming codependent with them. Now, this is very careful because we could ride the pendulum too far the other way. How this works out is a kind of strategic withholding of yourself. And I think this is true even in discipleship relationships. If you're a Christian leader, you should be discipling someone as well. The goal of discipleship is not that someone becomes more and more reliant on you, but that they become more and more reliant on Christ. And so in a sense, you have to have a kind of boundary marker there. Now, for the pastor, this is not a distancing from the flock or a neglect of pastoral care. In 1 Peter chapter 5, one of the other passages where we see qualifications, Peter says to the elders to shepherd the flock of God that is among you, which I think presupposes you're among the flock, that you're actually embedded in the congregation. So it's not about removing or distancing or isolating or insulating yourself from them. That would be a direct violation of Peter's command. But the pastor's role is to equip the saints for ministry. And this cannot happen if he does all the ministry himself. So it's a good thing to kind of regularly hold back enough, pastors, that if you were to get hit by a bus, your church could continue to live and grow without you. Now, very few churches advertise for a pastor who will lead a church in such a way that they won't need him very much. But I think it's a goal to have. Now, there's a variety of ways to kind of resist the development of this sort of codependency. If you have plurality of pastors in a church, that you actually engage that plurality, that the other elders in a church do not simply serve as committee members or a council of advice, but they're actually engaged and active in ministry as well. I think it means for a lot of leaders actually obeying the command to rest. Having a regular time where you're not working. The people of the church will survive. The person you're discipling will survive. If they won't, that's giving you some kind of clue about the nature of your discipleship relationship, isn't it? that maybe it's not so healthy, that you're not actually discipling people into maturity. If they, man, if you're gone, they bottom out. I think it means getting serious about leadership development and replication. I think it means putting family health above church's expectations. I think it means delegating. This is very difficult for some leaders. It was difficult for me. Because I was the kind of guy, even though I'm not great at everything, I wanted to do everything so that I would know it was done the way that I wanted it to be done. Does that make sense, anybody? And I had to get to the point of accepting less than the kind of work that I would do in order to empower others. And people can't actually get better if they don't get opportunities in certain areas. Here's what I know about human beings, including saved ones. We will settle for functional saviors. We will. But the reality is none of us have what it takes to provide what the Messiah, the true Messiah, does. Christian leadership is about leading people to Jesus, not just into better skills or more awareness or to be emulators of us. Follow me as I follow Christ. Rest, boundaries, margin. That may be something you need to remember if you're one of those go-getters. You need to rest. Even God, who never gets tired, stopped working. He rested. How much more we, fallen, finite, frail, do we need to stop and remember we're not God? Boundaries with certain relationships. I remember at my last pastorate, I had to carve out a day to say, this is for my wife. Because what I discovered, especially in the context that I was in, that ministry is going to spill into every single nook and cranny of this, if I let it. And every day is going to become a rivalry between feeling obligated to the church and loving my wife. And so I had to say, Fridays, that's my wife's day. Now, you know, ministry doesn't always stay in neatly compartmentalized spots, so there's emergencies or things like that. Obviously, you make exceptions. But just the general business of ministry life, I created a guardrail around Friday. Now, what happened was this got out into the congregation. Jared takes Fridays off to be with his wife. And wouldn't you know that there's a series of requests for meetings in which people would say, it's got to be Friday, Pastor. So, well, then I guess it's not to be. And sometimes they got angry. But you know what's worse than a congregant being angry with you? Your spouse being angry with you. Or just being disappointed. I created a boundary around that day. I had to do that within days as well. How about margin? What is margin? And I think a good working definition of margin is it's work, it's unscheduled or unplanned work time. So I realized if I didn't actually kind of buffer days where I had meetings and things like that, I could easily run myself into burnout by just going back to back to back and not having time to just stop and breathe and look in the scriptures or read a book or something like that. So it's work time, but I don't have anything scheduled there. I just leave that hour at the end of the day perhaps to kind of decompress, wind down a little bit. I can, and then if things need to shift or move in, I actually have some margin. Oh, I can give up 20 minutes because I've got this hour that's just a buffer zone at the end of the day. Some of you are running with no margin at all. You have no ability to flex. And so things just keep pushing, and the next thing pushes, and the next thing pushes, and you just feel completely crowded out. If not physically in your calendar, just mentally, you feel completely crowded out because you have no margin in your life. You need to fast from being needed. You are not Jesus. You cannot be available 24/7 like he is. Now, how is this gospel-driven? This rhythm is gospel-driven because only in the confidence of the gospel can you relinquish your fear of man, which is typically the hurdle to implementing these things, Relinquish the fear of man and the rush, the adrenaline rush of being needed in order to rest. This rhythm is gospel driven because only in the humility of the gospel can you embrace your smallness, your finitude, your creatureliness in order to rest. Rhythm three is communing with Jesus as an actual person. Communing with Jesus as an actual person. Here is something I'm beginning to see in this, whatever you want to call it, gospel-centered movement, tribe. I don't even know what it is anymore. We're about 15 years into really kind of a gospel recovery movement. And there's some advantages to it. So from my vantage point at Midwestern Seminary, I'm beginning to have students on the younger side who, when we begin talking about the philosophy of gospel centrality, some of them will not know any different. They have effectively grown up in churches, or since they were conscious of what the church is about, they have been in churches that preach expositionally through the Bible, that sing Christ-centered songs, that have this sort of an ethos of gospel centrality. That's fantastic. That means we're on the verge now of a generation being raised up in good foundational biblical discipleship and not attractional ministry or any of its offshoots. That's great. The danger, however, in that is that growing up in it, they don't appreciate it as much as those of us who did not, who know the stark difference between shame-based discipleship and self-help, legalistic, moralistic preaching and teaching. Those of us who kind of grew up in that, when you find this gospel center thing, you think, how did I not know this was missing my whole life? You mean you can actually focus on Jesus? You can actually just bask in the glory of Jesus? What a wonder that is. And so the danger is, for some, gospel centrality just becomes kind of like the wallpaper. It's on the books, you know, gospel-driven ministry. It's on the podcasts, and it's the conferences that you go to, and the websites that you visit, and all that sort of thing. But it doesn't actually get into the bloodstream. Gospel centrality on paper, but not in person. I'm beginning to see this more and more. And what is the solution? In fact, there are those who are committed to gospel-centered preaching and teaching because they have a gospel-centered philosophy or ministry philosophy. But when you get to know them, you think, you know, you're not a very gracious person, actually. What's the disconnect? They have forgotten to actually commune with Jesus as an actual person. Now, there's two ways to take that. The first is that when you are engaging in your devotional time with Christ, when you're communing with Jesus, and what a great privilege it is that we get to commune with Jesus, the one whom by faith we have union with, we get to have communion with. It's not just some kind of legal declaration, although it is that also, but we actually are united to him spiritually. You're his brother or sister. His father is your father. So when you engage with him, when you commune with him, you remember, first of all, that you do it as an actual person, a real human being, and not as a ministry bot. Not as a religious person. I gotta have my quiet time. Over time, it just becomes robotic, ritual, routine. But when you bring yourself and you bare your soul, when you remember to be your true self with him, you begin to experience more and more of the change he wants to do in your life. The other side, however, though, is that you commune with Jesus as if he's an actual person. Because he is. Now, I know that's not a radical thought at all. We all know Jesus exists. And yet, in your prayer times, you ever sometimes it just feels a little dry, feels a little ethereal. Sometimes, I'll just be confessional, sometimes I just feel like I'm like praying to the force or something. I'm just praying and it's just, and my mind begins to wander. And I just think, you know, do I stop now? What am I doing? Because I'm talking to nobody. I mean, I'm talking to God, but like, you know, the invisibility becomes a hurdle, becomes this sort of spiritual hurdle for me. Exodus chapter 33, verse 11, thus the Lord spoke to Moses face to face like one would a friend. I don't know about you, but when I read that, my heart leaps. The Lord spoke to him like a friend. How much more so on this side of the incarnation, crucifixion, and resurrection and ascension of Jesus Christ do we have a friend in God? Now, we can't see him face to face yet. But knowing he has a face, that's helpful to me. I don't know. I'll tell you how weird I am, if you haven't already thought I'm weird. This is how weird I am. You may think it's creepy. I've had somebody say, Jared, that's creepy. Don't say that to anybody ever again. But here I am about to say it, because I want to be an actual person in front of you. I try to picture, when I'm praying, Jesus' arm hair. And here's why. This may not work for you. I'm not saying you should do this. It's not me. You know, I'm not exhorting you to picture his arm hair. But I do because that feels real. He has an arm that has hair on it. I don't know what his face looks like. Someday I will. But I can picture an arm with hair. I know it's funny and it's silly, but I picture that and I think he's right here. He's my friend. And he has a body. He's glorified. He's risen and ascended. But he's taking up space. He didn't give up his infleshedness. You ever think about that? How much stranger heaven actually is than we typically think it is? We think of like disembodied bliss, but heaven is like it's a higher dimension. There's like more. It's more like Enoch is there, I suppose. Elijah and the incarnated, resurrected, glorified Christ is there. And so I picture his arm here, and it helps me to visualize he's an actual person. And he's my friend. He has an arm that's going to go around my shoulder someday. He has a hand that's going to hold my hand someday. He has eyes that I'm going to be able to look into. I'm going to see as I'm seen. Someday I'm going to know as I am known, and I just try to hover around in that thought, just kind of in the back of my mind as I'm bringing my request to him so that I remember he's real. Now you go into your prayer time with that, you begin to see the transformation in your communion with Christ. I have a friend by the name of Ray Ortland. He is a pastor in Nashville, Tennessee, actually recently retired. But when I was in Nashville, I planted a church in Nashville, Tennessee, the actual same year that Ray did. And he and I became friends, and we started this, what we called a pastor's gospel group. And I was astounded because I was hungry for this. Not many people were interested. We couldn't get many pastors who were interested in this thing at all. So we had about two or three other guys who would come and join us, and we would just meet in Ray's study. And it really was just a means of us being able to sit down with Ray and let him talk to us. And one day, he came in, I'll never forget, he came in, we were sitting in chairs in his study, and he came and he sat down, and this is what he said, I want to tell you about my friend Jesus, just like that. And I don't know what the other guys were feeling or thinking at the time, but I was thinking, I know Jesus, Ray, you know, like, you don't have to evangelize us, kind of thing, you know. And he started talking about Jesus and describing his relationship with Jesus. And something happened in the room. And I know it wasn't just me because my best friend David, who was a part of our church plant team, was there also. And to this day, he testifies he had the same experience. Somehow the room got smaller and bigger at the same time. The way it felt was, if you've ever seen, anybody seen the film adaptation of The Fellowship of the Ring? Do you remember in front of the hearth where, I think it's with Frodo, it might have been with Bilbo actually, where he's lusting over the ring and something happens where Gandalf like gets big and the room like goes, there's like some kind of a special effect. And Gandalf like fills the room and he's terrible and beautiful at the same time and the room shrinks. It was like that. That's how it felt in this moment as Ray was talking about his friend Jesus. And from that moment and any other time that I meet with him, I walk away thinking, this guy actually knows Jesus. Like, he's actually friends with Jesus. And I was just sharing with Jared earlier, it's one of the few relationships that I have where I feel incredibly challenged and convicted every time I spend time with him, but never in a shameful way, always in a beautiful, gentle, loving way. I walk away from my time with him thinking, he actually knows Jesus. And this is what it does for me. It makes me want to be being with him makes me want to be the kind of person that when people are with me and walk away, they think, he actually knows Jesus. That's what I don't think I'm there, but that's what I aspire to. And the only way I know to get there is to actually be friends with Jesus. Not just go to church, not just study my Bible, not just say my prayers. You got to do all of that stuff, but as a means, as a stewarding towards my relationship with Jesus, that I might become a more Christ-like person, which is the whole goal of following Jesus. And therefore, if I'm going to lead others, if I'm going to preach others and teach others and disciple others, I want them to become more like Jesus. And the best way to do that is not simply by replicating information, theological knowledge. Those are all important things. The best way to do that is to actually be a Christ-like person myself. I don't know what that does for you, but for me, it's helpful to know that this rhythm is driven by the gospel, because it's by belief in the gospel, by faith in Christ, that we are united to Christ mystically, spiritually, crucified with him, the Bible says, and raised with him, and the Bible says, seated with him in the heavenly places, hidden with him in God. Here's why it's gospel driven. His commitment to you is, you will be like him. Can you get over that? I mean, I don't know you, but someone in this room is the worst Christian among us. It may be me. Maybe I should just say that. It's me. But then there's one of you who's the second worst. But if you're a Christian, praise God, you're going to be made more like Jesus. That's his commitment to you. That's why it's called good news. Isn't that wonderful? I thank God for that. As terrible as the day has gone, when I lay down at night, and I think, oh, man, I shouldn't have responded that way to Becky. I shouldn't have responded that way to the student. I shouldn't have frittered that time away on social media. I should have been, I just think of all the should-haves that I should have been doing. All the ways that I blew it. And I look up at the ceiling, and I'm picturing my friend Jesus looking down at me. And he's not saying, I had no idea you were like this. You know, when I brought you on the team, I really thought you were going to be an asset. And you have been nothing but a liability the whole time. Now, he's looking down with approval, if you can believe that. With a smile, if you can believe that. And some of you maybe can't. Because I say this sometimes to others, and it doesn't land for whatever reason. Sometimes for noble reasons. God is holy. Why would he look at me with approval? Because he's looking through Christ. Because to disapprove of you would be to say, what I paid was not sufficient. But it was, wasn't it? You have by the gospel not just a relationship with Christianity, but a relationship with Christ. A communion with the living Christ. Fourth and final rhythm. Because of that, returning now to the gospel for your validation. Returning to the gospel for your validation. What is it that leaders too often find their confidence in, their justification in? It is typically some vision of ministry success. Approval rating, spiritual feelings, something like that. When I planted that church, same time as Ray Orland planted his church, I was so arrogant, and I didn't know it. I didn't feel like I was doing an arrogant thing, but this is how my arrogance was showing up. This was in suburban Nashville, Tennessee. I had all the stuff that everybody said you ought to have to grow a church. We had all young people. We had a cool name, which looking back was really stupid, but at the time we thought it was cool. We had a cool name, and that was about it. We had young people and a cool name. which I thought that's all you needed. We were in a contemporary space. We had like all the stuff they say, like you're not going to attract people if you had. So like we had all the stuff that you needed to basically attract people, the kind of people that we wanted anyway. And then we began meeting in Emmanuel Church's building. That's the church that Ray planted. We began meeting in their building on Sunday evenings. And so every now and then we would go for moral support for Ray and his little upstart, you know, congregation. We would go on Sunday mornings to worship with Ray. And when we first started coming, we would be the only people under the age of 60 in the space. So it's like Ray Orland preaching, you know, to the Senior Citizens Council. And this is me being arrogant, by the way. So if you're getting mad at me, I'm mad at myself for thinking this way. I just remember looking around going, how in the world is this? First of all, I was upset for him. I thought he deserves better. And I just thought, this is not how you grow a church. My church does not exist anymore. Emmanuel Church, I don't know how many they're running now, but Emmanuel Church has been going strong for almost 15 years now and has grown exponentially and is multi-generational now, praise God. But they have their core members that were there. And I was there on, I think, the 10th anniversary. It might have been earlier than that. It was a milestone. Just visiting, and my wife and I were in the service, and Ray got up and basically said, when we started this church, all we had to offer God was our brokenness. That's all we had. He was acknowledging we didn't have the assets. We didn't have all the stuff that people say you got to have. We didn't look young and cool and flashy. We just said, God, here we are. And the Lord, it's almost like the Bible says things about his strength being perfected in weakness. The Lord began to grow and to prosper them. In the days of my church plant, I remember there were times when we had more people in our band than we did in the sanctuary. And I was glad when the music was over, I could actually preach to people because the band would sit down. And there were times during the music, I would go out into the foyer of our space and kneel down and just beg God to just send one person through the door. Somebody I'd never met before, just somebody come visit. And every now and then people would come in, they'd hear about us in one way or the other, and it just never quite worked out. We just never could kind of get things going. And it was a kind of crisis in my soul. And I had to resolve in that moment, am I doing this for an imagined crowd? Or am I doing it because God has called me to do it? Because he is worth it. No matter what happens out here, he's worth it. Is that what needs to happen? Well, I left that church and went to pastor a historic church in rural Vermont. It was 200 plus years old, started in 1788. White steeple church building showed up. It looked like the beginnings of Ray Ortland's church plant. We had a band, which was nice. We also had a pipe organ that we used as well. We do four songs with a band and three hymns with a pipe organ later. It was all the things that people say. And I had people who call me and say, you're going to Vermont from Nashville. Jared, I had people say, you're going to kill your career. That's what I was told. And my arrogance works the other way. It's like, oh, yeah, well, let's kill it. You know, like that pushed me. It was like reverse psychology. It pushed me actually into Vermont. I'll show you. And so I went to Vermont from this failed church plant, and I had all the stuff that I thought you weren't supposed to have to grow a church, and the Lord started sending people to our church. In this town of like 700 people in Vermont, which I don't know if you know anything about New England, it's the least church region of the nation. Vermont routinely is at the bottom of the list in terms of religious affiliation. We're like number 50. And I did the exact same deal that I was doing. I didn't do anything different. All I know to do is just preach through the Bible, show people Jesus. And I didn't have the assets that I even had in Nashville. And God said, all right. And he just started We couldn't turn people away. People are standing up, and we used to call it the foyer. They call it the narthex. I don't know if that tells you anything about the kind of church I was in. They're standing up in the narthex, Pastor. It's like, is that a biological thing? What is a narthex? I don't even know. You got to tell me what a narthex is first before cars are filling the parking lot. And people get real happy because they've been praying for years. The old timers have been praying for years the church will grow. And suddenly young people are showing up and couples and there's babies and you hear crying and it was all very sweet. And then they start patting you on the back. And I started liking that. And then I felt very convicted because I remember those days at Element Church in Nashville, Tennessee in the foyer praying that God would send just one person through that door and resolving to myself, okay, this is not what I'm in it for. I can plant or I can water, but it's God who gives the growth. And I would say to my people, this is a good thing and we should enjoy it. I'm not saying we shouldn't enjoy this at all. In fact, we'd be abnormal to be upset that people were showing up to our church. Sometimes you hear, like I hear guys who say like, we must be doing something right. Nobody's coming. We're the faithful ones. Like, well, you could be a jerk. That might be what's happening. I don't know. Like, it doesn't always work the other way, you know. And so as the people got really excited, I would say, look, first of all, you give me credit for the increase. I know what happens if it begins to decrease. I get the blame. So let's just be faithful and let the Lord determine what the results will be. Because here's the thing. If your heart is tuned to the results, you're simply setting yourself up for a roller coaster of maybe even depression. For me, it would be depression. My heart tuned to how the church is going is bad news. My heart tuned to my advocate in whom there is no shadow of turning, that's good news. And that's power for me. Maybe constantly measuring isn't always such a good idea. One thing I'm helped by is that Paul, in none of his letters, ever asks anybody, how many are you running? He doesn't seem concerned about it at all, actually. If he was, he wouldn't say half the stuff he says, first of all. Leaders, Christian leaders, need to be tuned to a deeper reality, a foundation that holds sure through gain and loss, increase and decrease, that helps us to rejoice in the increase in good God-glorifying ways and helps us to rejoice in decrease even. The reality is that the kingdom of God is unshakable. Faithfulness to its values and trust in its promises will ensure success both in season and out. One thing I think... I'll wrap up here. One thing I think the last year and a half has been showing us, and I don't have a lot of deep insights about COVID, and I distrust anyone who says that they do, because I mean it's not the first time even our culture has been through a pandemic, but it's the first time we have, I suppose. And so in that sense, it's unprecedented. It's not globally unprecedented, but for us, it's unprecedented. And so I don't know all that the Lord is doing, and I think a lot remains to be seen. I think anyone who's drawing conclusions at this moment is probably jumping the gun. It's going to take a few years to process what has been happening. But what I think I've heard from a lot of pastors and ministry leaders over the last year and a half is they're actually discovering who their church actually is. I think it's a means of the Lord actually pruning and refining. We're discovering, please hear this the right way, we're discovering who the real Christians are, but we're seeing where the real church is. And in a way, it's like this global version of what happens when a new pastor comes to a church, and usually around, this isn't always true, but generally, usually around year two or year three, it gets real. And there's some kind of crisis in the congregation or just existential crisis of it got real. This is what I say to my residents because they're all green and looking, you know, to their future churches and they have these visions and these, what Dietrich Bonhoeffer calls the wish dream, the version of the church that they want. That's kind of in the front of their heads. And so I see it as part of my job to kind of pop that balloon for them. But I think I'm preparing them. This is what I say. You're going to show up to some church because the normative size church is not a mega church. So most of these guys are going to end up in small to medium sized churches. in our tradition, we're Southern Baptists. A lot of these guys, they want to go back home, and for back home, a lot of times is in rural areas. Most of the folks that I have, not all of them, but most of the residents that I have tend to come from rural Oklahoma or Arkansas and places like that. They want to go back home. Said, you're going to show up with your, you know, beautiful young wife and your little baby or your little kids, and it's going to be awesome. They're going to love you. They're going to love everything that you do. Everything's going to be wonderful. The first Pastor Appreciation Month is going to be fantastic. You're going to have gift cards like spilling out of your pocket. They're going to adore everything. By year three, you're going to wonder, do they hate me? Maybe year four, maybe year two, but typically around year three. Your kids are a little older. They're not as cute. They've actually seen them in action. And they wonder about your parenting skills. Or they're in that teenage phase now, and they're a little, you know, awkward looking. So they're not as cute anymore. There's a widespread disappointment that every woman who wanted to be best friends with your wife realizes that is a goal not achievable. And the gloss is going to come off. And you're going to disappoint somebody for the first time in such a way that they're going to think, well, this is not what we thought you were going to do or be or say. You're going to shut down a program, or you're going to say no to someone or yes to someone else. You're going to do something that in their mind violates the wish dream pastor that they had. And suddenly they're not going to be the wish dream congregation, and now you're at a loggerheads. But here's the beauty of it. You actually discover the church you really have. It's like the dating relationship, right? Do you know your spouse as well during the honeymoon as you do 5 years in? Of course not. Things got real. You smell the smells. You see the sights. You find out who you actually married. The same is true in ministry. And what's great about this is exactly what grace is for. It's not for the good times. I sometimes think, like, in the marriage vows, it's like, for better or for worse. You don't even need to say the better part. What's the point of that? As long as everything's going fantastic, I'll be right here. Well, of course. The vow exists for the worse. You find out who you're actually loving. That's what grace is for. Your grounding is not the ministry. Your grounding is not your leadership. Your grounding is the gospel. If you want to experience power and peace in your ministry, you will meditate on your qualifications, not your accomplishments. You will rest from being needed, fast from being needed. You will relate to Jesus, commune with Jesus as an actual person, and you will return again and again to the gospel for your validation. It's the only means of transformation for you and for others. Let me pray for you. Heavenly Father, I hope this was helpful. I hope that this was in some way edifying. I thank you for the gift of your Son who makes all of this worth it. What a privilege it is to help other people see in some even small way, the glory of your Son, Jesus. Help us not to neglect that in our own private time with you. When we come to church, even this Sunday morning, help us to gather with expectation. This is maybe the day that the Holy Spirit pours out something extraordinary. You are good and you do good. We praise you and thank you for who you are, not simply for what you've done, but just for who you are. Thank you for loving us and loving us so well. And it's in your Son's name that we pray. Amen.